Welcome to the Mighty Podcast. I'm your host, Dave Johnson. We'll be talking about almost everything related to organ transplant. They say the harder rock and roll is to be. And from what I see, I believe them. Now the other may be barely breathing. But the harder rock and roll, harder rock and roll is to be. Yeah. Prednisone. Ah. You trifler of emotions, you bringer of nightmares, you reckless party crashing messenger of doom and depression. You, prednisone, you get your very own episode on this show, such as the havoc you wreak in the lives of we, the transplant recipient. We love you because you keep us from rejecting these wonderful gifts that we've been given. But man, you're hard to live with. Guys, if you haven't been on prednisone yet, and I don't know why you wouldn't have, if you've had the transplant already, or if you've had a little rejection, you have been. If you haven't been on it yet, very large chance you will be. I was on it and have been on it for a longer period of time. I'm weaning off of it now at 5 years. Some people stay on it their whole lives, though I think that's a little less common. When this demon drug is not being pushed into your system via IV, it comes in this small, innocent looking little white pill. And how can I describe this? It is an emotional and psychological boot camp unto itself. If it wasn't so hard on the kidneys and it really had no other physical effects on the body, I'm convinced it could be used as a psych drug and marketed to test some really horrible things. Like if you're worried that your marriage isn't as strong as you think it might be, try prednisone. Find out the hard way. If you suspect that maybe you're a worthless waste of oxygen who will never amount to anything, let prednisone get right to the bottom of those insecurities and go over them one by one, methodically, at night while you should be sleeping. Or if you're wondering, as you know, some transplant patients, many do at one time or another, if you quote unquote deserve to receive an organ, or why the donor's family in your mind blames you in some inexplicably cosmic, bizarre mix-up, prednisone will do a deep dive right down into the closet of your darkest fears and paranoia and help you sort that out. Well, maybe it won't help you sort it out so much as it'll just help you to wallow in that. I can't even, if you were to take the worst parts of puberty and let's say a messy divorce and betrayal by a trusted friend and maybe like an impending apocalypse and pack it all into one itty bitty little pill, it would be prednisone. Now, some people say it doesn't affect them, that they get a little bit weepy or just overly happy sometimes, but they kind of learn to control it. And they don't really understand what the big deal is. And I'd like to say to those of you in that camp, on behalf of those of us for whom prednisone was nearly traumatic as our diagnosis of organ failure, good for you. Kindly skip to the next episode. If you want to hear about my jello-induced existential breakdown and how I nearly split my chest incision open and should have been kicked out of a theater during a children's movie, stick around and we'll talk about prednisone. My relationship with it has been extreme, and I'm going to tell you all about it because I see post after post after post on social media from transplant patients who are just in the first days and weeks after the surgery and confused about this. Why did I scream at my husband for bringing me coffee? Why am I rethinking the number of children we've had? Why do I feel like the dog is watching me when I'm not looking? It's prednisone, guys. It's prednisone. There's no mystery. I'm just gobsmacked that doctors and coordinators aren't warning people about the side effects of prednisone. It's like a roller coaster ride to a side of your brain you didn't know was there. A friend of mine said when she got home from the hospital, she was sitting watching TV quietly with her husband one night and just started to boil with rage, thinking, she said, I was literally thinking, look at him sitting there breathing. like he owns the whole damn place. Well, of course, he wasn't breathing too loud, and he did own the whole place. But prednisone, it can turn spouses into enemies and friends into spies and pets into sources of anguish and paranoia, and everyone is against you. And if you haven't been on it, you may be thinking, well, how can it really be that bad? Brace yourself. I'm going to overstate it because I don't want you to blow it off like, oh, it'll be like a side effect from drinking NyQuil or maybe taking too much cough syrup. This is a 24/7 prolonged, psychologically problematic medication. It's used because it's effective. However, it comes, for some of us, it comes with very dramatic side effects, I think is maybe the word that I want to use. I had an ileus after transplant, which means, and this was in the first week, it means my digestive system was like on strike, nothing moving. So in goes this NG tube and no food, no water. That lasted for about 4 years, according to prednisone. It was 4 years. It was actually 4 days. And when my plumbing started working again, I was finally allowed to eat. And I will never forget that meal. It was a chicken breast with fake grill marks and some, let's call them green beans, and mashed what I hope were potatoes, and a little cup of cherry Jell-O. And the food at Penn State Hershey, and I've said this before, it's so bad that it really deserves an episode of its own just to prepare those of you on the transplant spectrum who might be thinking of going there. It's the greatest hospital in the world for a heart transplant, but you know, the food might give you pause. I mean, it's really that bad. You know, adjectives fail me. I would have had to learn some really nasty words in French to adequately describe the gut churning aversion I have to the food there. There's nothing like it. And the room that I was in just happened to be where, when they fired up the grills in the morning to start cooking their quote-unquote hamburgers, the smell would drift across and come through my room, and I would wake up to it every morning around 5:30 a.m. That's what greeted my nose whenever I first woke up. You know, there were the needles and the bells and the sleeplessness and, you know, sick people all around me. One of the things I could not wait to get away from when I left Hershey Medical Center was the food. Anyway, I could digress for a long time about that. I had not eaten in 4 days. They could have given me a live raccoon and a spork, and I would have figured out a way to eat. You know what I'm saying? So I tried to eat like a civilized human being and not just cram it all in my mouth at once like a starving man, because I thought I was starving. And I came to the Jell-O, although it's, you know, a beef-based product of questionable origin and edibility. And I ripped the lid off and I just dug into it without thinking. I typically don't eat Jell-O, and it was cherry-flavored. So on the list of things that I would eat last, if there were only, you know, 100 foods left on the planet, cherry Jell-O would most likely be very near the bottom of that list. It could have been fungus flavored, though. I was so hungry. And I was sitting there eating the Jell-O. I had a nurse who was, she was not new, but we were new to each other. And I'm sitting there eating the Jell-O, and she didn't talk much. She's used to her patients kind of being out of it. And I said, you know, this doesn't taste too bad. For some reason, I just never really choose cherry. Whenever I have a choice, like with popsicles, for instance, or pie, I'm always going to go with orange or apple or strawberry or blueberry. I'm never going to really go with cherry. I just have never really liked the flavor that much. But this cherry Jell-O, it's not that bad. And I'm thinking of all the times, you know, whenever I was a kid, we'd be playing outside in summertime, and mom would say, hey, here's some popsicles. And you go, and there's this box of popsicles, and everybody's grabbing the green ones and the orange ones. And there were two red colors. One was lighter, and you knew that was strawberry or maybe raspberry, but all I knew was the darker one was cherry, and I really didn't want the cherry, so I would take anything except that. I started thinking about that as I was eating this cherry Jell-O, and I said, you know, it seems like, yeah, I've had some things that are flavored with this that I just didn't care for, but it's not bad altogether. I've probably missed out on some cherry flavored things that might have been good. Who knows? That might have converted me to liking cherry, or at least not leaving it last. And I was sitting there thinking about that lonely cherry flavored popsicle in the box when I was a kid, that it was like the last one that anybody would pick in this poor popsicle. And I just was seized with emotion and empathy for this inanimate frozen, corn syrup flavored thing. And I started weeping, uncontrollably weeping, sobbing. And through my tears and where I could get a breath, saying, I need to give cherry more of a chance. When I get out of here, you know, and I had, by the time I was done with the meal, I had in my mind developed this whole treaty and that I would give cherry, the flavor cherry, a chance from now on, that I would give it a fair shake. And, of course, the nurse is just standing there going, I don't know what to do with this crazy person. And it occurred to me, I said, is this the steroids? And she said, yeah, Dave, it's the prednisone. Do you want more of the Jell-O, or do you want me to take it away? I said, well, I'm gonna finish it because I owe it that, you know. So this is the way I respond to prednisone. So the next day, Christy and I are talking about some friends that had kind of drifted away during this whole thing that we'd been through. And I was fine with that. I've always said, you know, if I could have walked away from it all, I would have done that. I don't blame anybody for doing that. The problem was that they kind of set about after that, making trouble for our kids and telling other friends of ours that I was not as sick as I was actually making out to be. Now, I did end up having the total artificial heart implanted a few months later that set the record straight. But over the course of this conversation with Christy, I became almost homicidal toward these people, threatening to leave the hospital right now and take my revenge on these people. And I apparently had a whole monologue about injustice and truth having its day and so on. Hours later, same day, guys, hours later, I'm trying to go back to sleep and a song popped up on my playlist that I was streaming to a little Bluetooth speaker that I kept there by the bed. And it wasn't a particularly emotional song. It didn't really hold any grand significance for me, but it was called June. And the lyrics, it's June came upon us much too soon and then was gone. It's kind of a nonsense lyric to the song. It's kind of a fun sing-along song. It's a band called Spock's Beard. But as I listened to it, I realized, hey, I was transplanted on May 24th, and now it's June. I made it to June. And for some reason, this was vitally important at that moment that I had made it from May to June, which induced a fit of sobbing that was so intense, again, that I couldn't catch my breath. It was like a toddler. Just my emotions completely out of control. Christy had to remove the song from my playlist along with a few others that caused either rage, grief, steroid-induced introspection, political indignance, on and on and on. I mean, it, music affects me strongly anyway, but it was just amplified at this point. I cried and I got angry about everything. I didn't have a single visitor that I don't remember breaking down into tears about something, followed by some other intense emotion, and then back to tears. This is maybe not normal, but this is certainly one end of the spectrum. So this is, when I say I have a relationship with prednisone, you get my meaning. Once I was home, we'd waited a few weeks, because I didn't want to get out around people, that quickly, being immune suppressed. And we went to a matinee because we figured, well, there's not going to be as many people there. It's a kid's movie, Finding Dory. You remember there was Finding Nemo, Finding Dory had just come out. And loved Finding Nemo. So I don't want to go see this movie. The kids want to see it. There's a scene toward the end where a bunch of fish are accidentally released into the wild through a comedy of errors, violently in slow motion. If you remember the scene of the truck going backwards off the cliff and all the fish coming out in slow motion, and Louis Armstrong starts singing What a Wonderful World, and there's an voiceover by Sigourney Weaver, and something, whatever it was about the timing and absurdity of that scene, struck me as hysterical on levels like previously unknown to humans. I gut laughed so hard. And for so long after the scene, it's like the thing was over. We've moved on. I'm still cackling, you know, like I'm at a comedy show. The people around me, I'm sure, could not hear the movie. I couldn't stop. My wife suggested I step out until I could get it together, but I couldn't get up and walk. I was so doubled over with laughter, just crying. You know, I was so hysterical. I thought it was so hysterically funny. And I've seen that movie since then, and I still get really cracked up over it, but not like that. It was just over the top, the reaction. Prednisone causes other emotions that I can't really describe because I don't think there's an English word. It's a mixture of loneliness, dread, and I don't know what the dread is for, but just this looming sense of dread, hopelessness about the future, regret about the past, apathy to do anything to get yourself out of this funk. It makes you want to be alone, but then you're kind of panicked whenever you are. And you wonder why you did any of this in the first place, because nobody really cares, and you're depressed to the point of not being able to articulate any of this. I would climb the stairs to go to bed at night once I was able to do that on my own and start crying halfway up, and then lay in the dark and wonder why everybody hated me and no one wanted to be around me, and recount every bad thing and every wrong decision I've made in my whole life, all the way back to when I was like 3 years old, and berate myself and have this deep shame and regret and melancholy. And then I would wake up the next morning and be, man, it's great to be alive. I can't believe I'm here. What a wonderful gift I've been given. And I'm fine. I'm on the whole other end of the spectrum. But then possibly cry at some point because my wife, you know, brought me something to eat, you know, and she's the best wife ever. And I loved her so much, and on and on. And I can't believe she stuck with me through all this. And just, it was like a soap opera 24/7. I was awful on this stuff. The point I'm trying to make is that there's no balance. And in these moments, you feel like you're standing outside of yourself watching this stuff happen. And one of the best things you can do is to at least make sure that your family is aware of the side effects of this medication. They're easy enough to Google. Additionally, I was in the minority that doesn't tolerate Prograf very well, which a lot of us are on. And I had to be switched to cyclosporin for many of the same reasons, except on top of all the emotional craziness, Prograf caused intense migraines that I ended up in the ER for several. I was a real treat on these high doses of prednisone coming out of the surgery. I had rejections, two or three rejections, for which the treatment is, guess what? Prednisone. You get to go in and be blasted with 1,000 milligrams of IV prednisone for 3 days in a row. And then they send you home to your loved ones. The effect of this, it's much how, you know, I've never done drugs, thank God, because it would have killed me back when I had hypertrophy and didn't know. But it's how I imagine people on cocaine act, having never done that. Like, they're hyper. They don't need to sleep. They don't need to eat, though I was ravenously hungry, and you typically are on prednisone. And very, very motivated, and plenty of energy to start everything from painting projects to music projects to revolutionary movements, college, new careers, inventing languages. I would fly for days like some kind of mad genius. At least in my mind, I was a mad genius. For about 3 days after they hit me with this stuff, and then I would crash like a junkie for about that same amount of time. Nothing's worth doing. No one cares. Everything has fallen to ruin. Vanity, vanity, all is, you know, just everything's dramatic. So an attempt was made to wean me from prednisone after about 2 years. I was on 10 milligrams a day at that point. And the first five were not that bad. They went slowly. You know, they did just a milligram or two at a time. And I'm saying wean when I really should be saying detox, because that's what it's like when you really get down to the end. Prednisone is a steroid. It covers up a lot of other aches and pains. And I really started feeling that around the 5 milligram mark. And this is different for everybody. Some people have no problem coming off of it. But my family happened to be going out of town. My wife's a travel nurse, and she was able to take a job back in Arkansas where we had lived at the beginning of all this. Both of her parents were having, her mom was having a surgery, her dad was having cancer treatments, and she just wanted to go and spend some time with them now that I was okay, and just, you know, be there to help them get through this time. So the kids went, visited them, saw my family a little bit, but really just were there to support them during that time. And I'm still coming off the prednisone, but I was handling it pretty well. About the 3 milligram, I was feeling pretty good. I was home with the dogs and decided, you know, I'm going to take on this project. We've been meaning to paint the living room. It'd be a great time to do it because I'm the only one here. You can move the furniture and blah, blah, blah. I felt great at first. Glad that I was getting off the prednisone. I hit that 3 milligram mark and it was in the middle of all this. We'd ordered drapes and some other odds and ends. And I remember starting the job, starting to paint the living room, but I don't remember finishing it. It's like I kind of woke up one day and the painting was done, the drapes were hung, and the furniture was put back, and I did not remember doing any of it. I still don't. I just had little flashes of lucidity where I knew where I was and I knew what was going on, but then I'd be in a fog again. And we had no idea. You know, my family obviously would not have gone anywhere had we known that I was going to react this way to this. When I finally came down off the last milligram, I lost about 2 days completely, where apparently I was just going through the motions because the dogs were fed and letting them outside. I was eating. There was evidence, you know, of dishes. So I'd been eating, and I don't know what I was doing during that time. It's just gone from my memory. I came to myself kind of like snapping out of a dream, and I was sitting in the floor of our kitchen with an electric screwdriver in one hand and a spatula in the other. Now, I don't know what I fixed or what I cooked. I have no idea, but I got up, took a shower, and I was fine after that. You know, but it was a weird week or two there coming down off of those last 5 milligrams. Unfortunately, I had a biopsy about 3 weeks later that showed, again, a little bit of rejection. So I had to go right back on to the prednisone, but they kept me at 5 milligrams. So that was about 3 years ago. My team here at Stanford now in California is tapering that off again, and it's not been as bad this time, but every time they decrease this stuff, in dosage, I become spaceman for a day or two and have some type of emotional train wreck, and then it evens out. So you're not alone. What I'm telling you all this because people are I see comments where they say, I feel so bad. Why am I treating people this way? I don't know why I'm acting this way. This is not normal. This is not me. It's not you. It's the prednisone. Your coordinator, honestly, your coordinator and your doctors, someone somewhere should have said, hey, you need to be prepared that this is how you're going to react potentially to this medication, because some people react to it very strongly. For others, it doesn't bother. And again, great if it didn't bother you, if it doesn't bother you. For me, it was all the worst things that everybody says about it that I heard. Anecdotes and stories, and I thought, ah, it can't be that bad. I severely underestimated how out of control my emotions were as a result of this medication. Glad I had it, because I went into rejection a couple of times and it saved me. But the trade-off is you're a nut job, honestly, if you're like me, when you're on it, and when you come off of it, you're a space cadet. That's my experience with prednisone. It's terrible. It's one of those things that it's not funny when you're going through it, but afterwards you can kind of look back and laugh a little bit and think, my, what in the world was going on in my head? I've got about 2.5 milligrams left to go. It'll be about 2 or 3 months, I think, they're going to start weaning me off of that. So, you know, at that point, if I'm on here crying about how unfair it is that, you know, blood orange is the new rage and passion fruit never got a fair shake, you'll go, oh, that's the prednisone. Make sure your family knows that you're aware that you're acting like a crazy person. Apologize when you need to. This is part of it, unfortunately, for most of us, but it only lasts a little while. So cut yourself some slack. Don't stress. It will pass. It'll even out. You'll start to be able to figure out what's you and what's the prednisone at the very least, so that you don't think you're losing your mind. You go, ah, it's the drugs. Just hang in there. It'll get better soon. All right. Thanks for listening.